Okay, thank you everyone who has been so kind to stop by in Twitch chat, and thank you for stopping by to watch episode 5 of Rhevs Palaver. I'm super excited today to talk to one of the best friends I've made on the internet, the lovely and intelligent Safara. Before I bring her on, I want to talk a little bit about how we met. We met playing Star Wars The Old Republic. Very good MMO. It's gone through a lot of changes from when I first played it in beta testing to the time when I played it pretty seriously for about 2 years. And I understand that it's gone through some changes since then. So why wait any longer? Let's get our guest on. Safara, are you there?
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. How you doing?
I'm doing good. How about you?
Oh, I have been really going pretty crazy, go nuts on this whole Twitch thing. I don't know if you've been following it, but I actually streamed for about 8.5 hours yesterday.
That's awesome.
You know, it's addictive. It's you mentioned before the call started, you're thinking about getting into streaming.
Yeah. I can't on this toaster, though. There's no way it could do this in Star Wars.
I can't believe you're still on the toaster, to be honest.
You know, adulting costs money.
Is it the same toaster that you played Star Wars in?
Yes.
Oh, my Lord. It was a toaster like 3 years ago, Saf.
But this is... I got this computer for my 21st birthday. So it's only almost 3 years old now, so... I guess it still is the same one.
Yeah. Well, 3 years is pretty good for a computer. When you get about 5 years for a computer, that's when you're dealing with obsolete technology, basically.
I'm planning on building one.
A desktop?
Yeah. When I get the funds. I just have to pay for some other things first, but here's hoping.
Like toys for Kitly.
Yes.
So... Safara has a beautiful kitten named Kitly.
And she's in the other room right now.
Yeah, we're hoping that Kitly will make a guest appearance. Camilla has left the room. Camilla has started to get to the point where when she hears me talking to the monitor, she leaves the room. Because she understands that if she's within arm's reach, I scoop her up and show her to the camera.
She's like, I'm not into this right now, Dad.
No. So let's jump into the Star Wars thing I wanted to talk about. So backstory, just for those who are watching who don't know the both of us. We met playing Star Wars The Old Republic. I was the guild leader of SWW. And before my co-GM blew it up. And I can't remember how I invited you. Do you remember? Did I invite you? Did someone else?
No. Days did on Drum and Koss. I was on actually the tune that is Killa, my main now, was the first to join Slippery. It was actually Becca at that time. I hadn't joined on SAF until a little bit later. So it's actually Days.
Well, that doesn't surprise me. Days was great at recruiting.
Yeah, she had good recruitment messages.
Yeah. My recruitment messages usually had something to do with Bon Jovi playing on the whole, you know, Slippery When Wet thing.
But
she was a lot more creative with her.
Yeah.
Recruitment messages. It was the one thing she was really good at. Well, that and sending naked pictures to guys on the internet. But,
yeah.
You know, we all have our own strengths. So you ended up being... I'm not going to rank the top three, but I'll say you were one of the three healers in the guild that I loved grouping with. And I always tanked. I was a tank. So you value a good healer. But it was you, Bob, and Loina were my three go-tos. But
the good thing about that is we each played a different class. So you could say I was the best Sork healer in the guild for the time.
Loina was
the best op. Bob was the best merc.
That's true, but here's the thing I want to bring up, and I hope this embarrasses you. Do you remember the first time we grouped together?
Yes, I do.
Would you like to tell the story?
I was going to bring that up. I think it was me, you, I think it was Vil and Addy.
Maybe.
Because I was before I started playing with you, I was mainly doing like flashpoints and stuff with Addy and Bill, and I was having a hard time healing you. I think it was the first boss of Mandalorian Raiders, I think. And you're like, I'm not trying to tell you how to play your class, but you should probably use your bubble more. And I was like, oh, I had a much better healer now, even from when I was in Slippery. You would be, I would like to say you'd be impressed, but yeah, that was the beginnings of my actually, because before that, I hadn't raided. I was just a flashpoint hero and not a good one at that. Mm-hmm. So that was the beginning of where I'm at now.
Well, honestly. I generally never try to piss off my healers. And it was the first time I was grouping with this new guildmate, and I'm like, this sorcerer is not using her main heal, basically, which is putting a damage reduction bubble on the tank. And I'm like, she's not doing it at all.
I don't even know what I was like. I don't even know what my heal rotation. I mean, there's not a rotation, but I know I wasn't doing it right.
But I eventually was like, okay, we're not going to beat the boss unless I say something. So let me just say, hey, don't want to tell you how to play your class, but you got to get good, scrub.
Yeah, it was good. It was good.
And then, but then the rest of the instant, you're like, oh my God, it's so much easier to heal you now.
Yeah, they've made the bubble even better now. It puts a heal kind of like the shell that Mercs put out. It's kind of like that, but obviously it's for shorter because the bubble's only like 30 seconds, but that's stronger now.
Well, so continuing on over time, I finally convinced my insane co-GM that we needed officers. And you weren't the first officer promoted, but you were one of the most influential. And this was at the time when our guild became literally probably one of the top three guilds on the server in terms of how much we were progressing. And your role was...
Conquest officer.
Conquest! Not conquest, mind you.
Conquest.
Why don't you tell anyone watching who doesn't or didn't play Star Wars what Conquest is and why it was important to a guild?
So Conquest is something they added when they added, I believe it was the same time they added the guild strong guild ships. And a guild was able to conquer a planet. You invaded the planet, as it were, and you did different objectives, got you points. PvP, raids, flashpoints. Kitley's over here.
Kitley.
Oh, can't pull her. She got away from me too fast. She knew what was happening. So my job was to basically motivate the people in the guild to do these things. And kind of before this, we were a more social guild. We had just started our raid team, I think. I'm not really sure the timeline very well.
I think we'd been raiding a little bit before. See, the other thing is our original raid team, from start till basically we kind of, the guild fell apart. There were only two people who stayed on this, who were original members, me and Villa, and that was it.
Your original tunes.
We had started raiding, but, we were really just starting to ramp up.
Yeah. So basically I would just hound the people in the guild, bribe at times for certain things that we're not going to talk about, to get at least reach their conquest goal. And we really started to like pick up. We conquered some planets. We had a hater that competed with us that we went up against towards the end. We didn't end up taking it, but I was still very proud of the numbers our guild put up and how
you're talking about the guild that they didn't say. Yeah, and they ended up like they ended up recruiting.
They brought in other guilds to beat us. They couldn't beat them us on their own.
No, they ended up sucking in something like 100 members from other guilds just to say like, hey, come on, we want to beat Slippery, and so you'll get this title if you join and do this with us. And so they ended up sucking like 100 people.
It got kind of ugly there towards the end, but yeah. I always say that we did it the right way. We like would have, I think it was one of your favorite conquest things when we were all queuing for GSF against each other. There were so many of us. That was a fun night.
Oh.
Even though a lot of us were struggling, but we had the you and Red and Q carrying us, so it was cool.
And GSF, I'm not going to lie, I have literally considered reinstalling Star Wars just to play GSF. GSF, for those of you who don't know, stands for Galactic Starfighter. In Star Wars, there's PvP, which is much like any normal, you know, MMO PvP. But GSF, you were in a ship, and it was PvP in three dimensions. So it was awesome.
Basically, I just flew into asteroids and occasionally got an assist by magic.
Hold on, though. I hated GSF when I first started doing it. I thought it was the most ridiculous thing. I was like, who can do this? This is terrible. And then someone told me the secret. They said, you have to do GSF every day for 2 weeks. And at the end of 2 weeks, you'll be decent. Like, that's like the learning curve in GSF was so steep, and then it plateaued. And then,
yeah.
And I took their advice, and it was day 10. I remember day 10, all of a sudden I was like, hey, I got like third place in that match. Like, all of a sudden, it just started clicking. You never did that. You never did.
No, I really only did it when it was a conquest push. I never casually GSF'd.
Mm-hmm.
I was much more into PvP at that time. My obsessions in the game kind of peak and valley. When ops get kind of, I get kind of burnt out on ops, I go back to PvP.
Yeah.
Of course, before when I swear I would never PvP and it was stupid and I hated it. And then I started and became bloodthirsty.
You know, Reduxa is typing away in Twitch chat, which if you're looking at the screen is over here on my screen. Reduxa was one of those people who's like, I hate GSF, I'm terrible at it. And she was terrible for the first week. But by by the end of week two, she was crushing it. She ended up being amazing.
And on her toaster also.
Yeah, so. and she had a toaster too.
Toaster power.
So just want to give that shout out to Redums over here.
Red.
Reduxa. So, yeah, you are our GSF, I'm sorry, our conquest officer.
GSF, I'm not.
Sorry. I wish we had a GSF officer. I would have been the GSF officer, though, because I loved it so much. You are a conquest officer. You really drove us forward, but you are also our, one of our two healers for our, I don't want to call it, it was our main raid team, but we had two, and at one point we had three different raid teams. And what do we call them? We called them Red, Blue, and Yellow?
Mm-hmm.
And what team were we?
I feel like Red. I don't remember.
I don't either.
I can barely keep track of the names of the teams I'm on now. So. Yeah. They just change so much. Ours were at least easy. The ones I'm in now have some pretty interesting names. Kitley, come here.
Oh, Kitley!
Hi, Kitley!
Oh, cats are so autistic. They remind me of Luna.
That's Kitley.
Okay. Chad is telling us that we were blue team.
Oh, okay.
So we'll just go with people's memories who are better than ours. Yeah. So we were downing hard mode bosses in the Shadow of Revan expansion, and we were doing it like second and third on the server. So we were not, you know, we were not the best on the server, but we were definitely, what would you say, legitimate? I mean, you know.
Yeah, I mean, we got a lot of flack because of our guild and what our guild is known for. We didn't get a lot of respect.
You can say it. We're all friends here.
Our ERP guild.
Yes.
But I think we really surprised a lot of people when we, especially when we killed walkers.
Mm-hmm.
And we did get Bulu. We almost got Bulu before they nerfed it, which would have been way more for our credit. But
didn't we get it to like under 1%? Like,
yeah, it was hard. It was rough. Because... Yeah, that was, I still remember that night,
yeah.
but I still also remember when we finally killed, literally as soon as they patched it, we killed it, like, because we had it.
Yeah.
We just.
I mean, we had the pre-nerf version down to 1%, like.
Yeah.
but it just, it gets so crazy right at the very end.
Yes.
And as soon as one person starts dying, it steamrolls, like, and so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember there was one night we had it under 1%, and I was like, oh my god, we got it! And then we didn't, and it reset, and I was like...
Yeah.
I think Bob called that early that night then.
Yeah.
Because we didn't made one more attempt after that, and we died at like 14%, and Bob's like, no, we'll come back next week.
Yeah, we kind of backslid a little bit.
So, anyways, I played Star Wars back when it was being beta tested, and I was playing World of Warcraft at the time, and in beta, Star Wars was completely different than when I played it actively, you know, 2 years ago, 2 or 3 years ago. It was just a cheap World of Warcraft clone with lightsabers. It really, and so, after I quit playing Warcraft, I went and played Neverwinter for about a year. And then I was like, I'm kind of done with MMOs. And a friend of mine, who you may remember as No, N-O-H, yeah. She convinced me to give Star Wars another try. I said, yeah, it's free to play. Give it a try. And I'm like, hey, I played in beta. It sucks. She's like, no, they just changed a whole bunch of stuff like 2 months ago. So I tried it. And playing it for like 2 days, I'm like, oh. And I subbed.
Is that Rise of the Hutt Cartel expansion?
Yes. Yeah.
That's right around when I started playing too, but total different. I was like derping around with like willpower gear as a slinger. So
no, I mean, when I play my MMOs, I go hard.
Yeah.
but here's the thing: as much as the game changed from beta to Rise of the Hutt Cartel, there have been a lot of changes from Rise of the Hutt Cartel till now.
Oh yeah.
So that's one of the things I want to talk to you about. Is I've heard a lot of disturbing things about what's changed, and Kitty, you know, Akatai, Miranda, whatever you want to call him. he was talking in Discord the other day and trying to tell us about this new loot system. It sounds terrible. What is this all about?
So, you know, the traditional MMO loot system is you get a token for gear, or gear just straight drops from a boss. They've totally taken that out in Star Wars now. No gear drops from any bosses. It's all based on command experience. So basically, it's a whole new level of grinding mess. So you get, when a boss drops, you get you don't even get a crate. You get like a little, it basically is the CXP in a little pack, and you hit it, and it gives you however many command experience points. And that goes by levels. So when you hit a command XP level, you get a command crate, which is totally RNG based on what it drops. You are not guaranteed. You can either get a green gear, blue gear, purple set gear. And I'm level 31 now, and I have 3 pieces of purple set gear. And this is just story mode gear. So it goes from 0 to 300. So 0 to 100 is story mode gear that only story mode level gear drops. It's 230 is the gear level for that. And then it goes hard mode, 200, you get the picture, and then nightmare. So a lot of people, including myself, I've kind of just gotten, I don't want to say over it at this point, because it's so very frustrating, because they kind of went from one extreme to the other. And in 4.0, it was so easy to get gear because they had the highlighted ops that dropped, like, I think it was nightmare level gear. Yeah, a highlighted hard mode op would drop nightmare level gear. So an easy op like Karaga's Palace or Eternity Vault would drop nightmare level gear. And you could gear out totally nightmare without touching anything in nightmare. And at the same time, they fixed this later on in 4.0, but you couldn't even get nightmare gear from nightmare.
Wait, you couldn't get nightmare level gear from nightmare modes?
Yes.
I don't understand.
What would you get from a
nightmare
mode? Hard mode gear.
But was there hard modes also?
Yes.
So, okay, so you do story mode and you get story mode gear. You do hard mode and you get hard mode
gear.
And then
unless it's the highlighted hard mode, in which case you get hard mode gear plus nightmare gear. And this was in 4.0. So it was, I think there was many of us that had entire cargo holds full of token gear that we weren't even using. And now the opposite is I have 5.0 launched at the beginning of December. So mm-hmm. normally you could have at least geared out. We would have, in my guild, been geared out in hard mode gear in the first week, because mm-hmm. we could do hard mode gears in our nightmare gear from the previous pack easily. But now I only have 3 pieces of story mode gear. And I mean, there's people that have been farming CXP, like GSF dropped a good amount of the command XP. Yeah.
GSF, you say?
PvP drops, a ranked PvP in particular, is a great way to get CXP. But I'm working. Now I'm not in school anymore, so it's a lot harder for me to get gear, to spend that time grinding those levels just for a chance to get the token gear, or not, it's not even token gear, the set gear that I need. So it's, for a lot of people, it's kind of, a lot of people have left the game, from it. I know most of the people in my current guild were waiting, for January. They said that now that this expansion has passed, that they're turning their sights back to group content, which BioWare has proven that they don't necessarily see group content as raids. Mm-hmm. But if you think about it, it's been 2 years since Shadow of Revan, and that's the last time there was any raid.
Okay, so that's what I wanted to bring up. And I want to go into the massive exploit screw-up that happened in Shadows of Revan. Mm-hmm. But before I do that... So the game came out, and then I think the first expansion was Rise of the Hutt Cartel, right?
Yes.
Okay. So that's around the time I started playing, was after that was already out. Rise of the Hutt Cartel brought in a whole bunch of new raids. It increased the level cap, and also brought in some new flashpoints, which are dungeons or, you know, group content instances. Then after that, we had Shadow of Revan. And again, we saw...
You skipped one. Wasn't there an expansion that brought DP and DF? Or was that... That wasn't part of Rise of the Hutt Cartel. I don't know what they called it, though.
I could Google this, but that would be work. And I'd rather this just stay a fun conversation where we just argue about it. I don't remember. But my point is, so Shadow of Revan comes in. And we get more group content. We get more story. Shadow Revan had a fantastic story, as you're playing through. And it had 2 raids, right? 2? Yeah. It had Ravagers and...
Toss,
right. And that was good. Now, mind you, this was still following sort of the same model of World of Warcraft at this point, where... The old raids were garbage. You went there for fun. You didn't go there for gear. And the raids that were before that, they were even more garbage. You soloed them just for fun.
Yeah.
But then, after I quit playing, they changed it. And so they made it so that all of the raids are max level, right? Mm-hmm. So, my understanding of it is, as you said, it's been 2 years since Shadow of Revan came out. So it's been 2 mm-hmm. years since there has been any new raid content at all.
Yeah.
No offense, but how do you not just kill yourself doing the same raids over and over and over?
Well, and this is something that I say to the guildies that I'm with now. There's still content that I haven't cleared that I want to clear. Now that the nightmares are at level, a lot of people did the nightmare stuff in 3.0 when it was, 5 levels behind, and that's how they got those achievements.
Mm-hmm.
I unfortunately was not raiding or even knew really what I was doing in that era. So I think that was 3 something, I'm not really sure. But so there's still a lot of, especially the 16 man, I've done a lot more of the 8 man nightmare. There's just end bosses that I need. But the 16 man is something that I'm really interested in, still. And I'm an achievement hunter.
Mm-hmm.
So I get a lot of satisfaction in getting those achievements. And I don't know, I just love Star Wars. There's still stuff that I do outside of raids. Like, I'm really big on my strongholds. I have Tatooine Nowrak. I bought it. I caved.
I had them all by the time I quit too. Did they ever add a new one? I know they added the one that on the jungle. Yeah, I know they added Yavin. I don't think I bought that
Yavin.
One.
Not since Yavin.
It just sounds like there's been no content for the last 2 years.
There's been, I mean, all this expansion was story. Mm-hmm. You got all the chapters. The story was decent. I didn't really like the whole Knights of the Fallen Empire, Knights of the Eternal Throne. I didn't really like either of those stories. They were interesting storylines, but, you know, when you come off of a Revan storyline, it's kind of, I feel like to me, because, you know, I played Coder and Revan was Bay. Mm-hmm. It's hard to like compete with that. But they did add new group content, not a raid. It's basically a Flashpoint light, but more challenging, I guess. It's called an Uprising, and there's still four people ones, and they're still, so they've changed the titles. Things are now called, it's not Story Hardened Nightmare anymore. It's like Veteran is hard mode and Master is nightmare. I can't think of what the story mode is called right now.
Real quick, how long has it been since that expansion came out?
The newest one?
Yeah.
Beginning of December, I think, like the 2nd.
Wait, so the expansion just came out like a few weeks ago. No, wasn't there one before that?
Yeah, 4.0 was Knights of the Eternal Throne.
Uh-huh.
And that came out, I have no idea.
Okay. So we're going to avoid any spoilers for the expansion that just came out. So no storyline spoilers if you can.
Yeah.
Anything that happened before that, you can feel free to talk about. It's Luna's own damn fault if he didn't play it.
The story isn't anything really interesting to talk about anyway. Just like I said, it was all right. It was a good story. I love my characters, so it's fun to see them in the story. But I don't really play Star Wars for the story anymore. Not like I used to.
See, I feel like that's sort of the main draw of Star Wars. It's definitely not the best MMO in terms of gameplay, in terms of mechanics, in terms of graphics. I mean, really, Star Wars to me has two things going for it. And the first is the Star Wars franchise name. And the second is, it really is, it's BioWare. So it's a good BioWare story.
They're excellent storytellers. And I always say that I tried to play WoW, but there wasn't enough lightsabers. That's really the case. I love the way Star Wars looks. Even though I main a character that doesn't have a lightsaber, other people have lightsabers, and I don't know. I just enjoy the universe a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
I've tried other ones, but I can't. I wish I could quit you.
Yeah. Did you ever give the Secret World a try?
No.
Secret World, best MMO ever. By the way, best MMO ever.
If I try anything, I'll try ESO, but...
Oh, no, don't do it. No. Friends don't let friends ESO. I'm telling you.
It looks so pretty, though.
It's not. It's terrible. The colors are muted and gray and muddied, and the color palette is terrible. The Secret World has by far the best MMO system I've ever played, and I've played pretty much every system. The gameplay is a little weak, but the story blows away even Star Wars. Yeah. Yeah, I went there. But you know what it doesn't have is it doesn't have GSF.
Bold statement, sir.
It doesn't have GSF.
No GSF.
Klax is saying, lies, Black Desert. I don't know what he means. Black Desert's a pile
Black
of crap.
Black Desert sucks.
Yeah. And it's pay to win. Who wants to pay?
Yeah.
You know, who wants pay to win garbage? Oh, speaking of pay to win. Let's just talk about this, because...
I don't know where we're going, but I'm excited.
All right. Honestly, I really haven't harbored much anger or hatred or bile in my heart about what Bladaze did to our guild and how she destroyed... like, whatever. It's kind of like, if you keep poking a rabid dog with a stick, it's going to try to bite you. And I feel the same way about Bladaze. Like, it was only a matter of time until she blew up everything.
Yeah.
You know, she is what she is. So you kind of can't be mad about the tornado that destroys the house. Tornado's got to do what Tornado's got to do. But that being said, I had a couple people who were going to give me things like in game when I used to play, because I was the guild leader. Like, oh, you do so much for the guild, let me give you some loot crates. I'm like, oh, you don't have to do that, just donate to the guild, blah blah blah. And they're like, no, you deserve a reward. She always used to swoop in whenever she would hear people were giving things away, and she would snap them up, send them a pretty picture, and then all of a sudden I would never hear from that person again. And she was opening loot crate after loot crate after loot crate after loot crate. She had every decoration, every outfit, because she had a dozen guys buying her, you know, loot boxes, right?
Yeah.
So then, and I think you or Kitty were the one that told me, she got banned.
Yeah.
Yeah. What was the story there?
I wish it was on I'm trying to think, because this was a while ago, and Kitty might be able to know more than me, because I just saw that she was banned, and I was like, that's kind of hilarious. It was for, I don't think it was for wind trading, but that's what's in my head right now. It's not in my head, Rack.
Well, and she, her account already had several flags on it.
Yeah.
So it may have just been the final straw.
I can't remember if it was a money thing or not, though, because for some reason that's in my head, too. But that might have just been when they were rolling out bans for a different exploit.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like it was something PvP related, but I'm not sure.
Well, probably, since that's all she ever did.
But, you know, she came to Harvey for the PvP for ranked and didn't stay.
Oh, she didn't stay in Harvey.
No, you didn't know. No, she went back to BC.
Oh, amazing.
For the ranked, yeah. I don't know, because I didn't do the rank. I haven't really done ranked on Harvey, because it is much more brutal than BC ever thought of being.
And I'm sure that's why she went back to BC.
Yeah, she went back to BC so she could get her stuff, because it's much easier on an RP server.
She thought she was a good PvPer, and she was better than me at PvP.
Yeah,
but
she was good, but people in Harvey are like, it's their job, yo.
Yeah, she was good, but she wasn't great. And so she goes over to Harvey, and she gets face smashed, and so it's no surprise that she went back to BC. Well, anyways, that's enough sour grapes.
Yeah.
Like I said, I honest to God, honestly, I bear her no ill will. You know, she did what she did. The only thing that kind of bothers me is how badly she lied about everything she did.
Yeah.
Like, I typed up that, you know, 10,000 word document, you know, detailing everything that went down, and then she came in and just lied about everything and whatever.
That happened when I was in Washington, didn't it? Or was it right before I left?
I don't recall. I remember
it happened when I got back or something, because I remember when I was in Washington, everybody was talking about going to Harvey.
Mm-hmm. Well, it all happened really fast too. I mean, it all happened over a course of like 3 or 4 days. I mean, it probably started before that, but I mean, from when I got wind of it to when everything went totally tits up, it was like 4 days. And I did find out later she had been sort of working behind the scenes and talking to people, you know, to try to get them on our side before I even found out about it, but whatever. Let's switch gears here and get into something a little less sour grapesy. Now, I'm assuming you've seen Rogue One.
Yes.
And we're not going to talk about that because we're not going to do spoilers. But we can talk about something that I feel very strongly about, which is Episode 7, The Force Awakens. And how it's the worst movie in the franchise. The worst movie in the franchise, Saf. The worst.
I wouldn't say that. I would say the Attack of the Clones, probably my least favorite.
So that was Episode 2?
Mm-hmm. That was a lot of cringing. And I didn't cringe in episode 7, but in episode 2, when I was 12 watching it, I was, you know, 12 and like, oh, it's so romantic. But watching it now, it makes me like, oh, this, don't, no, stop. But I loved, oh, I mean, I personally, we're not talking about Rogue One, but I like Rogue One more than I liked Force Awakens.
I've heard people say that Rogue One is the second or third best movie behind New Hope and Empire.
It's phenomenal. If you haven't seen it, go watch it, guys.
I'll see it eventually. I've been busy.
But I enjoyed Awakenings. It did feel very, very similar to another Star Wars movie. A lot of the plot and, you know, murder things were very similar. But it is a strong female lead now. I enjoyed, as a female, I enjoyed that.
I mean, was Princess Leia not a strong female lead in the 70s and 80s?
But you could, she was a lead, but the movies were about Luke, you know, he was the main. And then it was like Han and Leia, like right slightly beneath him. So she was still like, she was, I mean, who doesn't love Leia? But Ray, I think.
Real quick, did you hear Carrie Fisher's in the hospital?
I did.
The latest report I got was that her condition is now stable. So it looks like 2016 is not going to take another one of our beloved celebrities.
That would make me so sad. Because mm-hmm. I think she's supposed to be in episode 8. So I was interested to see. I know she's not going to have, it's going to be like cameo-ish at best, I guess. Mm-hmm.
And we're not going to talk any spoilers about Rogue One, but my understanding is that they digitally did something to put in the actor who did Grand Moff Tarkin into Rogue One.
Mm-hmm.
Did it look good? Did it look realistic, or it sort of fake?
There were scenes that you couldn't tell it wasn't, you know, him.
Because he died in the 90s.
Yeah, but then there were scenes where they were more like shadowed, I guess. It was surprising how they paid a lot of money for that CGI. Like, but the more shadowy scenes, he looked perfect. But the ones where it was more well lit, mm-hmm. you could tell. Like, I immediately when I saw him, I was like, "Wow, they did that!" And that whole like wow aspect of it kind of got me past how kind of you could tell. Right. But then some of the later scenes, there it was very well done. So I was. They spent a lot of money, but it was. I think it was worth it because, you know, you can't have the Death Star without him.
No, I agree. He was definitely very, very iconic. Now, again, no spoilers. This was in many of the commercials, so this is no surprise. Darth Vader is in Rogue One. I know this. I haven't seen the movie, so if I know it, it's not, you know. And I have been avoiding reading anything about it. I've been avoiding spoilers.
Yeah, definitely still do that because they throw some stuff in there that just really makes it.
So my question is, though, is it James Earl Jones voicing it?
Yes.
Cool. I'm going to have to go see that. I've been busy. Like I said, I've been building my Twitch stream, and like I said, I was 8.5 hours on Twitch yesterday, so.
I made myself, you know, I don't know if I told you guys in the Discord chat, but I went and saw it by myself in IMAX because I wasn't going to wait like I did for Awakenings for somebody to take me. I was like, I'm taking myself on a date.
Well, I live in this tiny little cow town now.
Yeah.
I don't live in Buffalo anymore. And so we have this little tiny movie theater here in town that has like, I think, 2 or 3 screens. Mm-hmm. And I've kind of been looking at it, waiting to see Star Wars there, and they haven't had it. And I think they just can't afford it until it's, you know, been out for a long time.
That makes me sad for you.
Whatever. I mean,
'cause I'm probably going to go see it for a third time this weekend.
Oh, Saffy Poo. Oh,
it's Saffy so Poo. Good.
So let's see. I did have a list of things I wanted to talk to you about, but do you think I wrote it down? No, I was like, I'll just talk to her. I don't have to. I'll
remember. We didn't really finish talking about Awakenings. Yeah. I could talk more about it.
Okay, so here's my thing. I liked Episode 7. I did. I liked it. It was a great Star Wars movie. It was action and laser swords and shooters and spaceships. And It was everything you want in a Star Wars movie, right? But it was like eating cotton candy. There was no substance to the movie. The plot was terrible. There were plot holes a million miles wide in it. Some of the actors were good. Some were terrible. And I don't agree with some of the choices they made in the plot. Like, for example, I talked about this with Dave, who in my chat is nowhere near. I think one of the biggest mistakes they made in that movie is they had Kylo take his mask off way too early. They should have saved that for the scene with Han Solo. That should have been the big reveal. Like, yeah. Oh, he's not this monster. He's this beautiful man. You know? I mean, yeah. There's just so many problems with it.
I said that while I have issues with it, I think the main goal of this movie was to set up the rest of the trilogy. So it kind of took a hit in, you know, making us feel the Star Wars. Like, they did a lot of fan service in that movie. They you know, brought in a lot of those elements that make us, like, you know, remember Star Wars and why we love Star Wars. And they did that, and I appreciated it. But I definitely feel like it kind of sacrificed to be a little more innovative. They kind of stuck with what was comfortable. And I do agree that I felt like he took his mask off way too early. I'm hoping everybody agrees that Kylo is just kind of a little whiny bitch.
I mean, I think they could definitely improve his character a lot, but he did come off as whiny.
I think he's going to be much more badass in the next movie, because I think that was kind of his final thing holding him to the light. Mm-hmm. And now he's just going to be full, you know, hopefully he'll just be more centered in, you know, the dark side and just be a true, like, he's not, I don't think he'll ever touch Vader. Like, he can't touch Vader. No. But,
well, I'm going to bring this up so Dave doesn't have a coronary live in my chat. Dave and I had this talk, and Dave is nowhere near. If you are just watching my channel and you don't know nowhere near, you should check out his channel and follow him. He's really funny, and I really enjoy his stream. But nowhere near and I were talking, and he disagrees about Kylo taking his mask off. Nowhere near brought up the point basically that they wanted to make it so that it was obvious this wasn't Darth Vader. This guy was a lot different. He was in episode 7, Kylo Ren was battling between the light and the dark inside mm-hmm. of him. And yeah. They wanted to show that maybe he could go either way.
Yeah.
But I disagree. I think no one here is wrong. I think they should have kept him as a mysterious figure until the end. I think that would have been much more, a much bigger punch. For lack of a better way to put it.
That scene was already such a punch. I mean, I knew it was coming, but it was still a punch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, I predicted that they were going to kill him, like, way back when they first announced they were doing another Star Wars movie. And then when they announced that Harrison Ford had signed on, I said, they're going to kill Han Solo in this. And, I mean, you can even ask Loina, I think, months before the movie came out. I said, yeah, they're going to kill Han Solo. And, you know, Linda's like, why? How can you say that? I'm like, because Harrison Ford wanted to be killed off after the first movie.
Yeah.
You know, he kind of doesn't want to do this. You know, and he's getting old. He wants his character to have an exit.
Yeah, dignity. Die with dignity.
So. Die with dignity. Ugh. I don't know if that was dying with dignity, to be honest.
No, but it's better than, like, dragging the character along.
Yeah. And on top of it,
giving the new characters a chance to shine, really. They didn't, you know.
Yeah. And on top of that, it's also like in the plot of episode 7, when would have been a good time to kill him? You know, yeah. There wasn't really a great time. The only way
that was the best way for him to be killed, like, because it played a part, and it was the final string, I think, holding Kylo, like, his family in that connection, and, you know, murdering your own father is kind of,
yeah,
so dark side. It's
crazy. A little bit on the brutal side, yeah. Now, is murdering your own father as he's trying to hug you more or less brutal than killing a temple full of children?
I knew you were going to bring up the younglings. Well, you know, he is trying to, you know, continue Vader's legacy, so maybe he'll work his way. There's not, there aren't younglings, so right. He can't really be that brutal. He's got to work with what he's got.
That's true. I'm kind of running out of Star Wars stuff to talk about. I've got to be honest, and I think you know this, but I was never really the biggest Star Wars guy. Like, I like Star Wars because I'm an American and a male, so I think it's like a law that you have to like Star Wars.
Yeah.
But I was always more a Star Trek guy. You know, I know, sorry.
I can appreciate Star Trek. I'll watch it, but I've always been a Star Wars fan. And an addendum to that is, I always tell people my main Star Wars nerdiness is not the movies, it's the Old Republic, and the Old Republic, not even that, Knights of the Old Republic, the video games that I played obsessively as a child. So that's where my main, like, passion for Star Wars comes from. And the movies are just a great addition. And if Disney is intelligent, they will make one of their little spinoff movies the Old Republic. I can't even explain to you how happy and how crazy that would make me. Oh my gosh, Revan.
That is exactly where I was thinking we would go with this. Okay, so obviously we know that Disney came in, they bought out Lucas for, what was it, $4 billion or something like that, and they now own Star Wars, which makes Kylo Ren the prettiest of all the Disney princesses, in my opinion.
Certainly.
And I love Rogue One, even though I haven't seen it, just because it's not Episode 1, Episode 2, Episode 3, Episode 1.
It's the smartest thing they've done.
Yeah, like they're branching out.
It was a great decision.
Right?
Yeah.
So, here's my thought, right? When Disney bought it, they said, okay, we just paid $4 billion for this, so we're making the rule, the expanded universe, gone. The only things that are canon are the movies and the Clone Wars cartoon, right? How much do they need to make movies set in the Old Republic?
There's just so many places. They could do the Mandalorian Wars. They could do, you know, the Exar Kun. Like, there's so much content that they could take and, like, they just print money. Like, they don't even have to invest how much money they've invested into these movies. They could do, like, a half of the budget. Mm-hmm. And there's people crazy like me and people not as crazy like you that would go and see the Old Republic movies. Like, it's, to me, it's just crazy. And they did make, they did bring somebody in that they had originally marked out from canon back into canon with the Rebels TV show. He's going to be in season 3. It's slipping my brains. He's a Chiss. Thrawn? Admiral Thrawn. I believe that's right. They're making him... He's being put back into canon. So I'm hoping that they make more choices like that. Because it's just such a vast... Like, I get why they did it, because they want to have control over it. Like, they want to be the ones controlling the canon. But there are so many books and so much lore that they just, you know, threw out the window. But I feel like they could bring it back, and it would just be a smart thing to do.
And I think we have to agree, in fairness, if you pay $4 billion for a franchise, you have the right to throw out everything.
Yeah. You know? And it's like, it's setting them up. Like, I'm really excited. The Han Solo movie, I'm, you know, cautiously optimistic about. I don't know. I feel like they should have maybe not done that, because, you know, Han is Han. Like, there's already a young Han Solo movie. It's The New Hope. He's young.
Right.
That's Han Solo. Like,
he's young Han Solo there. So
I think Donald Glover will be a great Lando Calrissian. Pretty excited to see that.
Can I tell you how happy I love Donald Glover?
He's great. So if anything, I'll see that movie just to see how he does as Lando. Mm-hmm. Much more excited about the Boba Fett. think it's Boba Fett movie that they're planning. I know they haven't announced all of their like little side projects, but I think it's the smartest thing they've done is to just say, we're not going to just do a new trilogy, because there's so much more that they, you know, can work with in the universe, and it would be crazy not to.
Well, I think it would be a good idea to do a the final trilogy. You know, they did 7, now do 8 and 9 and end it there, and then expand the universe. Do things like Rogue One, do things like the Boba Fett movie.
And if anything, they could start, you know, kind of like, and this is a sidebar tangent, one of my other obsessions is Mass Effect.
Oh my god.
The Mass Effect trilogy, and they're starting completely new. It's probably going to be another, you know, trilogy at least with Andromeda.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would be a wise decision if they wanted to start something, a completely new story that could be a trilogy in the Star Wars universe outside of like the anthologies and all that stuff. I think that would be a great idea.
And I think we're going to save Mass Effect for a different time, because we're getting into the last 10 minutes of the podcast here. And if you and I start talking Mass Effect, that will be another hour.
That's true.
I think
easily.
I'm just going to say one thing. Fuck Miranda. that's all I'm going to say. Miranda is the episode 7 of the Mass Effect series. So many people like her, even though she's an ugly pan-faced dumbass bitch.
The booty.
Yeah.
I don't have any strong feelings towards her in any way. But
Liara is bae. Everyone knows that. Liara. Even if you're playing FemShep, you know, Liara, come on. No? You don't think
I disagree with you. I don't like Liara because I feel like she got fan service from the devs, and she got her own little DLC in Mass Effect 2, and I couldn't see Caden. He was just a jerk to me in Mass Effect 2, but Liara's all like, oh my god, I just love you so much, and let's just do things, and it annoyed me.
Let's get a timestamp here. We're, what, 52 minutes in? Loina, we need Safara going, oh my god, we need that as a GIF, and we need that in our Discord. So, Loina, make sure you GIF that up, because if oil is going to be a GIF, then, oh my god, it needs to be one too. So, yeah. I think there's a lot of potential for the Star Wars universe, getting back to it. I think that I would line up to go see something set in Old Republic, even if it wasn't directly based on anything we've already seen, like Revan.
Anything in that timeline.
Just to really separate it out. Even things like, okay, what was the one instance where you were on a base that would collect asteroids and shoot? Was it Hammer Station? Hammer Station.
In Old Republic?
Yeah, in Star Wars Old Republic, you go into this one, like, base, and it's like a primitive Death Star, basically. It would collect asteroids, and then...
That sounds like Hammer Station.
Yeah, I think it was Hammer Station. Like, that alone. Just take that concept, the development of Hammer Station, and how the Alliance developed it and then abandoned it as a project. Then it got taken over. Like, you know what I mean? Like, that's a whole movie right there.
Yeah.
You know? I don't know.
Plus, there's so many more. The thing that sucks about where the universe is at now is there's, like, 3 Jedi.
Yeah.
Or 3 Force users. And it's like, they had those, you know, in the prequels, but it wasn't too, like, you had all the Jedi, but you didn't have all the Sith. So,
right.
I want to see the universe where it's like, it's, you know, that opening, all the opening cinematics for the Old Republic that make me have chills. Like,
the one where the Sith
sacking
ship,
of Coruscant. Yeah, the sacking of Coruscant. That would be, oh my god, I would want to see that movie. Oh.
Now, this is the point where I think in editing, I'm going to go ahead and splice in a clip of the sacking of Coruscant so people can see the Jedi and the Sith fighting.
Like just that lightsaber ignition of that first, and then you see all the rest of them, and then you just see the Sith and the Jedi going at it. Like, that's what they need a movie like that. Like,
yeah.
They had a taste of it with the prequels, but it was all Jedi. You didn't see how strong, like, yeah, the Emperor and, like, Anakin, great, okay. But, like, the Sith Empire is, like,
well,
I just got very excited.
Okay. So, Anakin's whole thing was that he was to bring balance to the Force. in episodes 1 and 2, there's thousands of Jedi and two Sith, right?
I mean, he did balance.
He balanced the Force. Because in New Hope, there's two Jedi and two Sith. He brought balance to the Force.
He did.
And let's be honest, those movies are more interesting when there's balance, right?
Yeah.
But let's have balance with 1,000 Jedi and 1,000 Sith. You know?
So much better. Yeah. Oh my gosh, that would be so exciting.
I agree. We're getting low on time here. Is there anything else you wanted to bring up?
No, I think that was a great thing to end on. Now I'm just gonna be obsessed with the sacking of Coruscant and all that stuff becoming a story and becoming a movie. That would just be phenomenal.
Yes, I will. I think I'm gonna be doing a little Twitch streaming tonight. See if Loina and Hazmat and no one here want to do some move or die. But when I do get to editing, I think I'm gonna have to splice that right in. I'm just gonna cut it right in.
Give everybody the goosebumps of that. They sacked Coruscant, the stronghold of the Republic.
Yeah.
The Sith just came in and were like, nah.
Yeah. Redoxa, Tower of Doom. I don't know. We'll see what's going on. Redoxa wants to play an old school 1994 arcade cabinet game that we bought on Steam, and we played through. There's two games, and we played through the first one, and I don't know. We'll see. But it was so great talking to you.
Good talking to you too, Rack.
Beautiful and intelligent and smart, and I love you, and you know this. And
I
missed you when you were in Philly, but hopefully you had a fun trip. And I know Kitley was probably happy to see you again.
She wasn't acting as excited as I wanted her to act when I got home, but she's since remembered me.
Yeah.
So like when I came home from like going out today, she did her thing where she rolls on her back and wants me to pet her belly. So all is balanced in the Force.
Cats are not dogs, unfortunately. Well, you know what it is? Okay, so here's the thing. Cats make you work for their affection. And you left her for a week.
She was mad at me.
Yeah, she was mad at me.
It was 2 weeks. Yeah.
2 weeks.
Because, you know, I was gone in Philly for a week, and then I worked up until Thursday. And so it was like almost 2 weeks.
Yeah. And I want to say I love that you sent her to live with your parents for 2 weeks instead of putting her on the kennel or something. That's fantastic.
She needs love and affection.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm already feeling guilty about the fact that I'm going to be going out of town and leaving my cat alone for a day and a half. Even though I know that my mother-in-law is going to come here, and my mother-in-law loves Camilla.
Oh, couldn't love her?
Yeah,
she's so pretty and
she's
fluffy.
The most adorable. But I'm already feeling guilty about leaving her. So thankfully, Camilla, if it's like a day and a half, she's okay. But if it's any longer than that,
she's going to be like,
yeah, she's like, this is for you. You left me.
I don't like you right now. Yeah.
So, give Kitley some belly rubs for me, and we'll talk again on Discord probably even tonight. Who knows?
Yeah.
And we won't be doing Quiplash on Sunday because Christmas, obviously. But Wednesday, 8 o'clock, will you be around for proper nerd Quiplash?
Yep, I'll be there.
All right, great. I am trying to wrap up, but I got to say, I loved our Wednesday night Quiplash games. It's been so great. It brings back that feeling of raiding in a way, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's close. It's not, you know, wiping on Bulu for 2 hours, but
yeah, it's not as frustrating.
Yeah, we it's all just fun.
All right, well, I'm gonna let you go. I'm gonna give you the last word, and we'll say goodbye to everyone. And Safara, last word.
You guys make sure to listen in to Rev's podcast. I know they're great. He's a funny guy. He knows what he's talking about.
All right. Thanks, Seth. Talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye-bye.